are ready to sow your seeds. Fill trays with soil and put one seed into each cell. Place the seeds 0.5 centimeters or roughly a quarter inch deep. Cover the seeds lightly with a little more soil. Water the trays well and allow to drain. Seedlings will emerge in 7 to 12 days. Water seedlings lightly and frequently, usually twice per day, until they are ready to be transplanted. Seedlings should not be overwatered. You should also nourish the seedlings regularly by using foliar fertilizer. Foliar fertilizer is mixed in water following the manufacturer's recommendation and sprayed or watered onto the plant leaves. The nutrients will be absorbed directly through the leaves. Some are also taken up through the roots. Several commercial foliar fertilizer mixes are available, but a 20-20-20 mix is best. This contains the three main plant foods, NPK, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potash in equal proportions. Step 4. Carefully transplant seedlings at the correct stage of growth. The seedlings should be ready to be transplanted after 5 to 6 weeks or when they are about 12 to 15 centimeters or 5 to 6 inches high. To prepare the plants for the shock of transplanting, they should be hardened off for 5 to 7 days. Do this by reducing their water supply, for example, by watering every other day, and gradually exposing them to outdoor conditions. This will make them withstand shock and be less likely to wilt in the field. Transplanting shock can make plants come into bearing weeks later than normal. Now you are ready to transplant the seedlings from the nursery to the field. Since the seedlings are in lightweight trays, they will be easy to carry. The best time to transplant the seedlings is in the afternoon or evening, and ideally after rain or irrigation. Select only those seedlings that are the healthiest. Plants looking spindly, weak, or diseased should not be used. If any of the seedlings are diseased, they could affect your entire crop. So destroy them as soon as possible by burying at least 60 centimeters or 2 feet deep or by burning. Take seedlings from the tree with soil intact. Seedlings with bare roots will grow more slowly after transplanting and their roots can be damaged more easily. By keeping the soil around the roots, transplant shock will be reduced. Don't bury the stem of the plant too deeply. Cover the roots to the same depth as they were when the seedling was in the tree. Spacing. The spacing for hot pepper is very important. Make the best use of the land while not overcrowding or wasting space. Rows may be spaced 90 centimeters to 150 centimeters or 3 to 5 feet apart, with plants 90 centimeters or 3 feet along the row. For high density planting, rows 90 centimeters wide with plants 90 centimeters apart is recommended, but only at dry, low elevations where plants do not grow as large as those grown at higher elevations with good rainfall. Step 5. Apply fertilizer and irrigation at the times needed. Plants need sufficient plant food of the right type and at the right time to grow vigorously, fight off disease, and produce well. ICM ensures that this is done. Although pepper grows well on many soil types, different soils have different levels of plant food. Also, some soils will give up fertilizers to the plant better than others. Check with your local extension officer to identify the best type of fertilizer for your soil. It is also critical that you fertilize at the right time during the plant's growth and in the correct way. There are four main times to fertilize your plants. At transplanting, NPK 15-5-35 or 8-4-32 is suitable. Apply 28 grams or 1 ounce per plant. At flowering, the plants will flower about 40 days after they have been transplanted. Apply 28 grams or 1 ounce of sulfate of ammonia or 14 grams or 1/2 ounce urea per plant. At 25 to 30 days after flowering, apply 28 grams or 1 ounce muriate of potash and 56 grams or 2 ounces sulfate of ammonia per plant. After 2 or 3 harvests, apply muriate of potash and sulfate of ammonia in equal amounts of 28 grams or 1 ounce per plant. Thereafter, apply every 4 to 6 weeks depending on soil type. Fertilizer may be applied in a number of ways to ensure maximum benefit and reduce wastage. It may be applied in a circular band around the plant. The circle should be at least 10 to 12 centimeters or 4 to 5 inches away from the stem. It is also important to cover it with soil in a single band, 3 to 5 centimeters or 1 to 2 inches deep between double rows of plants, making sure to cover with soil. It can also be applied as a solution using soluble fertilizers through drip irrigation systems. And foliar fertilizers can be used where plants show signs of nutrient deficiency. For best growth and production, peppers need irrigation. Without adequate water, plants will grow poorly, wilt and not yield their best. Remember, ICM requires you to give the best conditions for proper plant growth. Signs of water stress will begin to show. These include wilting, the plant becomes droopy, flowers shedding and falling off, and fruits becoming soft and maybe also falling off. The main types of irrigation are sprinkler, drip, and furrow. For Scotch bonnet pepper, drip irrigation is the best because less water is needed, less water is lost, there is less weed growth, less foliage diseases occur, there is a more efficient use of fertilizer, and more uniform crop growth. When using drip, apply about 5,000 liters or 1,100 gallons of water each day for a 0.4 hectare or 1 acre field over the life of the crop. For the first 4 weeks following transplanting, irrigate daily. After this, depending on rainfall, irrigate whenever plants wilt at midday. If mulch is used, less water is needed. Step 6. Combine all available pest management practices. Peppers are affected by several weeds, insects, diseases, and a mite. If allowed to, they can cause severe damage to the crop and losses to the farmer. With ICM, the farm and its surroundings must be managed so as to make it difficult for them to do so. The aim is to produce healthy, profitable crops, promote human health and environmental well-being. ICM uses several measures together to achieve this. Using high-quality seeds helps to avoid plant diseases in the first place. Good nursery management gives plants a healthy start, free from serious virus diseases. Crop rotation helps to avoid the buildup of many diseases and pests that are likely to affect pepper. Proper land preparation also reduces the likelihood of soil pests and disease problems. Live barriers will help reduce virus disease carried by aphids. Protecting and encouraging natural enemies such as spiders, ladybird beetles, some wasps and others will help destroy pests at no extra cost to the farmer. Natural enemies of pests. In addition to the insect pests attacking your pepper crop, there are a number of spiders, mites, bacteria, viruses, and fungi which are causing no damage to your plants. They are called pest natural enemies. Pest natural enemies work the field daily, hunting and killing pests on the crop. They help to keep pests from building up in the crop. For example, this soil wasp catches caterpillars, lays its eggs in it, and buries it in its ground nest, where the young wasp will hatch out and feed on it. Some very tiny wasps feed and develop inside aphids, moth eggs, or caterpillars. Spiders hunt down and eat various insects, ladybird beetles, lacewing, and other fly maggots eat aphids and other small, soft-bodied insects. Some viruses and fungi infect and kill the pests, such as this caterpillar. Because pest natural enemies are usually small, farmers do not notice them. However, they are a very important part of ICM systems, working daily to help rid the field of pests. Sometimes, farmers even spray them mistakenly. When they are killed, for example, when insecticides are misused, the pests multiply freely and cause greater problems for the farmer. To protect the natural enemies, use all available non-chemical measures to avoid pest problems and reduce the need for pesticides. Use pesticides only when you have to. Use the safer pesticides whenever possible. Use baits where possible. Apply sprays in late evenings when most natural enemies are not active. In addition, many adult stages of natural enemies, such as this lacewing fly, feed on pollen and honeydew, which they get from some weeds. Farmers should check to see which weeds have many of these natural enemies feeding and keep a regular supply around fields. Major pests of hot pepper. Pests of economic importance to hot peppers are several weeds, aphids, broad mite, gall midge, crickets, and cutworms, leaf-eating beetles, and footworms. Weeds. Weeds compete with crops for soil nutrients and water. Some also harbor pests and diseases. Weeds such as white top, cowpops, black nightshade, and velvet burr must be removed from around pepper fields as they harbor a key virus which is detrimental to pepper production. The most critical period for weed control in peppers is the first 40 to 70 days after transplanting. If the field is large and weed growth heavy, chemical herbicides may be necessary. Paraquat, for example, Gramoxone or Guaiquat, will quickly kill the tops of most weeds, which will regrow after some weeks. For best results, apply at evening time. Fusilade and Agil kill only grasses, and glyphosate, for example, Roundup and Touchdown, kills most weeds. When spraying between rows of the crop, a spray shield should be attached to the nozzle to prevent spray drift and crop burn. Be extremely careful when using glyphosate. Non-chemical weed control methods are important. Farmers should never use chemical herbicides alone to control weeds. They are costly and can harm crops, man, and the environment.